Hi. Well, I admit to being in a somewhat of an apocalyptic mood at the moment. I'm sure that I'm not alone. I do have one more segment of my interview with Jeremy Cowan coming out. That was a response to the distributism seminar that I taught this summer, which was really great. We had about 30 participants, and Jeremy was among them, and he knows a lot about agrarianism. He knows about local agriculture, organic agriculture, and permaculture. And he's got a great interest in politics and social and cultural issues. So I had a great conversation with him. And the last segment of that will be coming out this Saturday. Sometimes things look bleaker than others at other times. And this is one of those times in our history where multiple extraordinary things have happened, including now the still ongoing pandemic. The unknowns of that are really quite large. We still have huge divisions in the United States, political divisions, and we're seeing multiple signs of a sort of decrepit social, cultural, political, and economic infrastructure. I'm always trying to think of what is the fundamental problem? And if we could get to the fundamental problem, we could maybe start finding solutions. And so one of the videos I did just, I think it was like the week before last, really seemed to hit a chord with people. It got a lot of views. And it was about the ping pong match that we have going on in the United States, in which, you know, people are at each other's throats, and how convenient it is that we are all arguing about these cultural issues nonstop, meanwhile being pretty much incapacitated from doing anything of a constructive nature, even for the issues that we care about on either side. So we're in this sort of stasis moment, culturally, politically, and socially. And the other day I was watching the finale of the latest season of The Handmaid's Tale, which is based on Margaret Atwood's book of the same name. And, you know, if you've watched that show or read that book, you know, there's this slow evolution. Well, maybe I haven't read the book, but at least for the TV show, there's this slow evolution, kind of almost like Breaking Bad style, with this central character, June, who is, you know, greatly abused in this, you know, nasty country of Gilead that's created in the wake of this like fertility disaster. And she's been victimized, you know, repeatedly and just gone through hell and back, and she gets out. And the number one abuser is like caught by Canada. And he's getting some sort of deal where he gets to go free. Because he's going to give them all the secrets of Gilead. And she has a choice to maybe not forgive, not sure that's quite possible emotionally for her at the moment, but at least to kind of let it go so that she can have her marriage back, even though she's lived a completely different life in this other place and has somebody else that she loves. She has the possibility of getting her marriage back and her child back and her friends back, and to, you know, fight in her own way against Gilead, but from Canada. But because of what she's learned, what she's gone through, and how it's changed her, she decides that she can't let that go. And she devises a solution to the problem. And I won't give it away, won't do spoilers to the specifics, but basically she solves the problem of this particular man who is the source of a great deal of her misery in Gilead. And in doing so, kind of like in Breaking Bad, she becomes somewhat monstrous. Okay. It's also very, very understandable. It's very understandable. Lord knows I'd probably do it as well. And one even admires her for her like strength and tenacity and warlike nature to be able to carry out this plan and to do what's necessary to stop this man from ever doing anything else ever again. So there's a lot to admire, there's a lot to understand, and yet in the process, she becomes thoroughly infected with this desire for and love of a certain type of power that exercises, you know, itself without any restraints or rules and outside of the normal moral framework and certainly beyond forgiveness. There's a scene before this where she talks to the man and she basically fools him into thinking that he is forgiven. Ah, it's an excessive heat warning. Well, no surprise, right? So, anyway, in doing that, I think she reveals that her character has fundamentally changed. Again, very understandable, even somewhat admirable in a perverse sort of way. But at the same time, she's become closer to the character of the man that she hates so much and the country of Gilead that she hates so much. She has changed. And she has potentially become a part of the problem in the sense that to the extent that she does this damage to him, and if, say, Canada did this much damage to Gilead, the problem, the ultimate problem would not be solved but exacerbated. And this is the problem ultimately of forgiveness. It's so hard to do. One cannot make one's heart change. And it's, you know, whole books have been written about what forgiveness even is. Is it good enough just to like decide that you're going to walk away and forget? Do you have to feel something? I don't know. But I thought that maybe this was a good time because I feel like our society is in a similar situation here. We have become on both sides and all sides, largely the monsters that we see on the other side. We have. There is a monstrousness about almost all of us, if not all of us. Well, yes, all of us, at least some of the time, and many of us most of the time. There's a monstrousness that means that we have kind of gone above and beyond good and evil. And I've been persuaded that it would be a good idea to go back to a moment in the past. I'm not a history teacher, so I'm not gonna dwell on the details, but I wanted to let people know that I'm going to go back in the past a bit in my next series, which is gonna start next week. And I'm gonna start off by dealing with John Maynard Keynes' reaction to the Versailles Treaty of World War I. Now, I normally say, hey, go out and get that book. I'm about halfway through this book, which is called The Economic Consequences of the Peace, and it was written in 1919, so not long after all of this had taken place. And he was there for a lot of these negotiations. He saw it, and he has these great descriptions of the central characters involved, like Woodrow Wilson and Lloyd George. But I wouldn't say go out and get this book unless you're just really into like the details of history. What I would do if you want to get ready for this is to read something on the internet or listen to another video on how World War I got started. Maybe a few. But this book is The Economic Consequences of the Peace, and interspersed amongst the details of what went wrong in the peace negotiations that led to the inability of Germany to be able to dig itself out of financial ruin, and that spurred the rise of fascism and Nazism that led to the Second World War. Interspersed amongst all that are Keynes's observations about why it was beyond these characters that were negotiating with each other to come up with a peace plan, despite Woodrow Wilson's 14 points, to come up with a peace plan that wouldn't lead to the total crippling resentment and hatred of the Germans that would lead to this. Keynes basically predicted that something like World War II was bound to happen. Because he calls it the Carthaginian peace that was imposed upon Germany was just too great to bear. And it was done largely because of two things, because of deep hurt and hatred, understandably caused by all the damage that Germany had done in World War I. But also because of deep beliefs that this was the only way that you could deal with a country like Germany. They would say, this is the only way you can deal with the Hun. This is the only language that the Hun can understand. So there was a resignation and a sort of nihilism interspersed between the weird optimism and la-la land character of the 14 points in a way. And so I want to explore that, how those two things can come together, an incredibly naive optimism and a sort of idealism, right, alongside an incredibly deep nihilism to the point of a sort of headlong rush into destruction and impending disaster and an inability to control one's own desire, greed, anger, resentment, hatred, thus becoming not a part of the solution, but a part of the problem and very similar to one's enemy. I'm going to explore this from many angles, but among those angles will be the spiritual angle. But there's also just the sort of practical angle of this. So that's where I'm going to start. I don't know exactly where I'm going to end. I'm going to use the book by Keynes as a starting point for a reflection on this problem that we have with being unable to forgive, let go, and to reconstruct things in a way that will lead to true peace, as opposed to just truce and the cessation of conflict. This is really mainly what we get in any sort of conflict is a truce type situation. I want to see exactly why that happens. And by doing so, hopefully begin to think about how we might get out of this trap. So that's my plan. And you will also be getting the final segment of our interview with Jeremy Cowan coming up this weekend.